So, how does a four-legged reptile go about losing its limbs?
Animals with limbs tend to have short vertebral columns, and they walk just like, you know, your dog or a turtle walks. And there's various things that they can do, the little adhesive pads on their toes and things like that. But basically, they move through the world like anything that has four limbs.
So the movement is kind of that.
That's right.
And
if you think about it, their vertebral column is turning as they walk.
So
it's doing this thing, a side-to-side thing. The thing about limbless lizards is not that they lose their limbs so much as that the vertebral column gets longer and longer. So the wheelbase gets longer, and you get that flexure then becomes multiple. And so at that point, they're in a sense swimming to their environment, and that's the point that you can start to lose your limbs.
I'm in Mexico's Baja Peninsula and nearing the southern end of Highway Number 1, which has brought me into the heart of mole lizard country. And here in La Paz, I've got an appointment with two herpetologists with a passion for this most peculiar Mexican lizard. Their favourite location for finding them might not be the most picturesque.
God, you take me to all the best sites, don't you?
But in this show, we tell it how it is. And very often in nature, where there's dust, there are diamonds. Still no worm lizards, but we've got plenty more derelict building sites that Victor and Carl insist are crawling with them.
Oh, there's a little lizard. There's a little gecko.
Little house gecko. Cool as that. Oh, that darked me out, that did. Not quite what I was looking for.
While I'm playing with dolls at the other end of the lot, Carl has struck gold.
You got something?
And after travelling thousands of miles, I may just have reached the El Dorado of herpetology.
You got one?
You're kidding me!
How cool's that?
Oh my goodness me!
And it's freezing cold as well, look.
Look at that.
And if you're not blown away by this amazing beast, then frankly, I think you need your head examining.
That is the most peculiar thing. It's like a little piece of intestine with legs on it.
With little hands, yeah.
This site has redeemed itself, having been such an interesting herpetological experience so far. It's just unbelievable. In the biggest pile of human excrement and waste comes this little fella. There's absolutely nothing like it anywhere else in the world. It's like it's a worm lizard that has retained its legs. It sort of seems like a sort of an oxymoron, really. There's not enough words in the English language to describe what I'm feeling right now. You know, normally you pick up a snake, and if you had a bit of experience picking up snakes, you kind of know what you're letting yourself in for. You pick up a lizard, you know what a lizard feels like and how a lizard moves. This is like nothing else. It doesn't move like a snake, it doesn't move like a lizard, it doesn't feel like either. It's half walking, half crawling. It's using a bit of rectilinear motion, what we saw the rattlesnake doing the other day as well.
To show you just how peculiar this animal is, I want to go back to our two classic, if simplified, reptile body forms, limbed and limbless. The limbed lizard, with legs mounted sideways, is a blueprint that can be adapted for crawling, climbing, or digging. Snakes and limbless lizards have evolved a different strategy. They propel themselves through sinusoidal motion, that's waves moving along their body, and rectilinear motion, dragging themselves along on their belly scales. At first glance, it appears that the mole lizard has adopted these two forms of locomotion together and added a bit of earthworm.
Now that's been an earthworm. That's how worms move. It's sort of a peristaltic motion. It's sort of just like a worm. It's got like weird segments, but then the segments don't continue all the way around the body. It's got belly scales as well. That's got to be one of the weirdest of the weird, surely. I know I've said that a few times in these series, but... Oh. And it's tongue-flicking, like a lot of reptiles do. So I'm assuming this guy has a Jacobson's organ and it tongue flicks in the same way as all the others.
Now, I want to examine how and why it's attained this remarkable shape. But while we're here, there's still time for a little bit more burrowing of our own.
What I love about this, right, is that this is all I've been doing ever since I was a little boy. When I was 8 or 10, all I did was go around and ruin my mum's rockery by flipping over stones. And I'm glad to say, it is a skill which has become very, very useful. So if you're a parent, don't be too hard on your kids for doing this.
Because one day, they too might turn up one of nature's real treasures.
So that's mine. Oh, man. So, just then, look at that. Just while we went off, we're just bumbling around by the backyard, I flipped over a fairly normal piece of looking concrete, just left bit here, flipped it over, and this animal was sitting just under the surface. Obviously, as soon as it was disturbed, it started backing up down its burrow. And I don't know if you've ever tried pulling an earthworm out of his burrow when 2/3 of his body are already in the ground, just like that. I got worried for a moment there because it felt like it was going to break in half. He's kind of a pile-driving animal. What he's doing is he's getting a purchase with his body. He's gripping with his body, but he's using his incredibly hard, heavily boned head and his legs to kind of alternate between driving his head, pushing his head through the substrate, and sort of scraping away any obstacles with his highly modified and mole-like front limbs. All right, well, that's bike is number 2. Very cool. We'll bag this one. Have you got something to put it? Sir?
It's time to get a closer look at these animals in action and find out why they've evolved into this remarkable shape. And we're better placed to do so than Victor's reptile haven, the La Paz Serpentarium.
Stick him on there. See what.
Look at that. It's just peculiar.
Now, Carl, you're collecting a number of these animals for what purposes exactly?
Well, one of the things is there's a lot of mystery behind this animal, a lot of things we do not know about bipedes. And what I'd like to do is be able to get a group of them, maintain them in captivity, be able to learn more about their reproductive ecology, what it takes in order to maintain them and essentially get an assurance colony started.